thank you. Yeah, I'm very happy to be with you here today, and also to see some of my very dear friends that I didn't see for some years. Oh, okay. So I have like 15 minutes to tell you many, many things. And I thought that I would show you a vision of the future city. This is actually a little research that came up together this year in 2012, when I suddenly realized, when I suddenly realized that I can compare two very different sites, two very different locations, two very different cultures. One is informal city of Caracas, in capital city of Venezuela, which makes more than half of the city of Caracas. I'm sure Hubert Klumpner, who actually invited me there, he initiated the Caracas case project in 2003. I'm sure he talked a little bit about that. And then on the right side, we see Amsterdam, the modernist part of Amsterdam, which is called today New West, which is like the same thing as with the Caracas informal cities. These are places of crisis. They are considered places of crisis. In the case of modernist, this New West neighborhood of Amsterdam, it's a part of the city that has been like in the redevelopment and is now populated mainly by immigrants who are not well integrated into Dutch society. When we worked there in 2009, this was the biggest residential redevelopment site in European Union, which was a very stressful condition for people who live there. Two very different communities. On the left side, again, my friends from Caracas, groups that we worked with, very highly organized, efficient communities. On the right side, two women that were a core of the community garden project that I did in Amsterdam. And when we started to work there, this was there was no community at all, public space was empty. There was a sense of hopelessness in, like, when we talked with residents, they didn't think they participate in any way to the city. They were like foreigners in their own city, and also being replaced or relocated all the time because of redevelopment. So these two very different communities have the same vision of the future city that I will explain a little bit later. But now let's look at us, and let's look at how, where we are located today. And I put these two images here for you just to explain how suddenly I realized why there is such a lot of interest in the informal city, if you want, or in different strategies to live together and different strategies of spaces today. When I reminded myself that in 2007 I saw an exhibition which is called Design for the Other 90% at the Cooper Hewitt National Design Museum in New York. And the title actually implies, this I think it's very interesting, the title implies that I, as a visitor of the exhibition, I'm the other 10%. However, in 2011 we have a photo or many photos from Occupy Wall Street movement, and the poster says we are the 99%. So just in 4 years, our sense of which world we belong to has changed. I think that's somehow why we are all having these debates currently. Yeah, I'll just make it very short. Basically, I said that I'm always invited as an artist to do participatory projects or community-driven projects in places of crisis, but I have to say right away that I consider these the communities I work with like communities that are laboratories of the world. So basically they are places of hope for me. I think that's very interesting. So the vision that I'm showing you today here, it's actually the vision of hope for people who make the majority, I say those two groups are representatives of the majority of people who live in cities today. So if you look at the city, so of course we are in this present, and the present is in the middle, so we don't know it's actually what's going on. But if you just, when I stepped back and looked what people from the two communities I worked with desired, we came to a very simple list. People desire small and well-organized neighborhoods and not a big metropolis, where there is an individual which is, it's actually they prefer communities to individualism. They prefer community space or shared space to public space. Public space has a problem today because it somehow for many of us means also a no man's place. And I would like to, it's for the simple reason we gather together when we go shopping, we gather together when we join entertainment, like, I don't know, going to the cinema, or when we meet with our business groups or like groups that we work with. But there is no space for gathering. And I was reminded by a friend of mine last week that Agora, the Greek Agora, started as a gathering space where people where citizens just discussed matters of civic matters as well. So it only at a later time it became a place of commerce. So somehow this gathering idea of the gathering space is missing. This is also why I believe community gardens are so popular today, because they offer this extra space when you can gather together and discuss also matters of citizenship. And then control of the land and space is more important than ownership of land and space. And if you look at people, there is always this idea, you know, what comes first, architecture or citizens, and I think we really have to learn from citizens today. So instead of thinking about architecture that implies some social change, we have to look at citizens, what they desire. So it's actually social architecture and not architecture, which is different what modernists believed in 20th century. And then collectivity and sharing against individualism and owning, and new culture of living against the culture that we are living today, which is fast, global, unpolitical, urban, and is focused on entertainment. Now, if you look at the list, you come to this very strange focus, which is not strange focus, but the focus that we live today, which is focus on the local, the small, and the independent. And just like I read The Economist, so 1 year ago, at the time when David Cameron, the right-wing government of the UK, started to talk about their program, they talked about a groundbreaking shift in power to councils and communities. And I thought it was super interesting because this is exactly the words that Hugo Chavez, the populist president of Venezuela, would use. So somehow you can see that the maybe left wing of Europe, they didn't define so precisely that how the state will change with actually the decline of the social state today. And I think it's very important to rethink how we can function on the local level. That's my sort of political belief, not only to react to the shrinking of the state, but also to be proactive. So of course the local is a big unknown. So future city, what does an Amsterdam neighborhood have in common with an informal city in Caracas? There are two striking ideas. It's rural culture, not urban culture, and it's community space, not public space. This is what people on both locations desire. And I have to tell right away that I don't consider rural culture only the culture of like the green areas or, I don't know, farms or community gardens, but also informal architecture. Caracas in 2003, when I was working there on a project that was one infrastructure project, it was ecologically dry toilet that we built that used no water to operate on the site where there was no running water available. I just lived in the informal city, but I didn't analyze it. So it just like this year, suddenly I realized that we were living in the rural culture. The informal city is about rural culture, and I will try to explain. People who built the formal city of Caracas came from rural areas of Venezuela. They settled in Caracas, and they knew how, of course, because they built the formal city, the modern city, they knew how to build modern architecture, but they didn't do it for their own communities. They insisted to build the way how they were used to live in the rural areas. So basically they built rural architecture. Why? Because rural architecture produces village communities. So it's actually communities, not the like anonymity of an individual. If you live in informal city, this is how you live in communities. So so in a way, I would also say that it's sort of fantastic how rural culture has been resilient, because in the 20th century, everything was about, the talk of the town was the urban culture, no? Yeah, so it's actually, you can see how it preserved against all odds, and it prospers still. There were also a lot of, I would like to add a few things about the informal city, because it was really not analyzed. Today many people are analyzing the informal cities, but not many are doing the comparison between all these different kinds of research. So this is what I try to do here today. But anyway, the informal city is, like was always talked about, a place of chaos. And when we lived there, we realized that it's a highly organized structure. It's just that everything is, the regulations are done as oral regulations. So you talk every little detail with people. So it's a big myth that people just build like crazy. This is actually a very agreed on structure between inhabitants. And of course we in our planned cities, we have written regulations. There was also all infrastructure in the barrios. For instance, there were all libraries and hospitals and so on. It's just that there was no representational face of it on the facade, so you were not able to read infrastructure on the facades of the building. And of course, most striking, it's the shared space. There is no public space per se in a barrio. Every space is shared space, and for instance, it also changes temporarily. So for instance, if one group would take control of one part of the alley, you would need to go someplace else. So everything is negotiated all of the time. But it's basically, what is very important is the shared space. In difference with the shared space in Caracas, we are looking here at New West neighborhood of Amsterdam. Modernist development built in the, like after the Second World War, designed as a garden city by Cornelis van Estern, a very known Dutch architect. And then, of course, when there was money to build the houses, but there was no money to actually activate the green areas or the social space, if you want. And this is actually the story now about decline of the public space in this neighborhood. So in the 1970s, when the buildings were standing there and all the space was just empty and green, this was a very nice coincidence, because In the 70s, open society meant open space. Now, the same space in 1980s became no man's land. And in the 1990s, it became fenced off. And we are looking here at one of such gardens that we worked in. It's called K Green Looking Only Garden. So basically, residents who live around it, they have to pay for maintenance of the garden, but they cannot enter it. They are not allowed to enter it. So, but the story doesn't end here. In 2004, the city of Amsterdam that became afraid to get bankrupt by high cost of maintenance of public space, they gave all the public space in this area to housing corporations. And that's very interesting because at this point the democracy was broken. So basically, you as a person who lived there, you were not able to change anything because the government institutions just serviced housing corporations, the business. Okay, let's go on. What is the time? Okay, I'm already too late. Yeah, okay. So so this was the garden before. And then, so when we came there was no one on the street, so we said, okay, let's get people together. And then after some discussions, we decided, I always work on collaborations, and in Amsterdam project I was invited by the Stedelijk Museum to do a project in this neighborhood because it was a neighborhood in crisis, no? And I collaborated with Wilde Westen, which is a group of young architects, designers, artists from Amsterdam and Rotterdam. And while working, of course, the Stedelijk Museum, they didn't have any money, of course, no? Like very little, 10,000 euros for the whole project, which actually became then a very successful project, and we were able to fundraise later. But in a way, when Stedelijk was also a good partner, I actually like to work with not only with just bottom-up like groups, but also try to partner with also with the city. Now I'm doing a project in Paris when we work closely with municipality. So I think this is very important also to have the different. Not only just to be marginalized because you work with marginalized group, but also to be able to change something with the project. So we started to distribute, or people chose their lots in the garden. And this was the garden 1 year later, evidently a big success. And it was a big success because it actually made community space for people. As you know, the community gardens are not really about producing food for your table, but it's actually to gather together and to organize yourself, and they're also political schoolrooms. So I just, as an afterthought, I put here like three images to actually locate also ourselves today, and the fact that actually we desire community gardens. There is a big movement in European cities, but also in the US cities about community gardens, as you know. And here on the left, it's a desire. This was not planned by top down, but it's actually produced by citizens themselves, especially in these Western cities like US and Europe. And what you're looking here is Alison Waters, the edible garden, who got very famous. She's from California. On the right side, you see sort of déjeuner sur l'herbe in our community garden in Amsterdam. So this is desire. But funny enough, or not funny, this is usually how the community gardens were perceived as in a crisis as a representatives of a crisis mentality. So basically, community garden was something that was shunned. It was produced by some big catastrophe like war. And of course, on the left side, we see Reichstag 1943 in Berlin, a community garden in front of it. And on the right side, we see like Eleanor Roosevelt's project exactly at the same time. She started the Victory Gardens in the same period. Now, I would like just to to also note the differences between allotment. Here is, I think it, I took this photo from Wikipedia, like describing allotments or Schrebe gardens, in, as you call them, and on the right side, community gardens. This somehow this working on the land always comes in the cities when the city is in transition. So allotments are representatives of this kind of phantasma at, when the city started to be industrialized. And of course, because this was a modernist city and functional city, if you want, the gardens were pushed into unfunctional sites in the city, like between the two railway tracks and so on. And of course, the garden is for one family. In difference with the allotments, the community gardens are happen exactly in your neighborhood. The best is that you control the garden from your window. And also the idea is to share the food, which I think is very exceptional, that people come together and with like the idea to share the food. And of course, the allotments, the community gardens for me today represent the idea that the city is again in transition, and this is produced by people themselves, so the citizens themselves. So in a way, the city is also an organic structure where citizens themselves make the city. So they pointed with the community gardens that the city we live in is in transition today. And then regarding space, what we also learned is that this occupying and working with the community space is actually an act of ritual. So basically you are a person who works in a community garden is actually doing a rite of transition, he's actually acting the transition of the cities that we are in. And there are two phenomena, one is working together and one is working on the land, which is totally not rational, but it's really ritualistic. And then also that we connected the garden with the community kitchen, and this is also the idea of placemaking. It was very interesting for us to understand. I didn't know it before it happened, but before we actually, the organizers, we withdrew from the project, and the citizens themselves ran the project in Amsterdam. The group started to fight about whom this place will belong to after we leave. And it's actually a very simple sociological term, which is called placemaking. A group wants to be recognized in society. If you want to be recognized as a group, you have to own a place, so place matters. Okay, so I'll just go briefly. Collectivity and sharing. Also, it was actually very interesting also that our project added security and the poor people of the poor neighborhood as an added value. So it would be on the right side you see a picture of some women or men from the center of Amsterdam that would come first time in their lives to this project and to see the neighborhood, to share with the neighborhood. And of course, the food, as I said before, it's not only about the food, but it's also about political organization, but also what I think is very important, to rethink the relationship between rural and urban in our culture. Okay, so now I come to the conclusion. What has an artist to do in this? And to, when I'm many times asked about is this art and so on, and I came to the conclusion that the main question is not what is art, but the main question is what is culture. Why? Because art depends on culture. So this is also how the art changes in the discourse. And art in this case, in these community-based projects, is a relational object, and that residents use as a tool to change culture again. And we are talking about new culture of living here. So culture is not only art, whatever, it's also culture of living, which became very important thing today. And art for me is very important because it mediates our relationship with the world, and artist is a mediator in this particular task. But it's not only mediation between residents and the institutions, but it's also mediating the imaginary of the city. So actually you are, as an artist or a designer in such projects, you are a part of the constructing and envisioning the imaginary. I think the visions are very, very important for our society because you have to have a vision to be able to go on. This is more of the same. What comes first, the chicken or egg culture or architecture or culture of art? I think it's culture. And these are the two relational objects which just an afterthought, where we used diversity of knowledge to produce new culture of living. On the left side, in the middle, you see the white sink is the dry toilet in Caracas. On the right side is the garden in Amsterdam. And this again, that we have two cultures, it's urban and rural culture, which should be the same valued at the same, like in my view, should be valued the same. And of course, rural culture is not only the green, it's also the informal city, because it produces different kind of coexistence. And art as a relational object can be a catalyst of change to of this, the urban culture, if you want to become a city of 21st century sustainable city. Okay, so just this is a relationship between the garden and the community kitchen. And of course we had a committee, I mean people in the garden organized themselves, they formed a committee that ran the project. And when we asked them what is our relationship, we said that they drew a little a tree here, you see in the middle. And they said, okay, your group, you are a tree, but from this tree we grew. And that's the last slide. And we chose another, like a manifesto that I made with residents of Bordeaux, which actually the same way demanded the involvement in the let's say democratic process and rethinking of the city. What was very interesting here is that we were a part of evento which with the title Art for Urban Re-evolution or Revolution. So it was all just community-based projects. And maybe at the end I would just like to say that there were a lot of manifestos in the 70s. So I would say that from maybe 68 to 2008, when we faced financial crisis, we were under the let's say the head of neoliberalism. But before was a very interesting moment in the 70s when people were constructing manifesto and thinking how they can contribute to the vision of the future, and this is exactly what's happening today. It's just that it's less utopian, it's more existential and more linked to the real. Thank you.
No, please stay, Marjetica. Okay. Thank you so much. This is actually amazing because Marjetica hasn't been with us yesterday, but she tackled all the subject that we discussed yesterday in the last session. There's many questions. There will be questions from the audience. Maybe I start. Yesterday, the last presentation we had was by Markus Wiesen. It was discussing participational processes and also in its difficulties on various cultures of assembly, which you also kind of research upon. And we had a long discussion about the influences of ideas, theories of the 60s and 70s that we are all somehow still involved with. And I'm very grateful for your last definition that at one point was maybe more utopian, while it is now existential, which maybe is a very great, a good summary of our question that we raised yesterday as well. My first question, you called yourself as the artist, as the mediator, which already is a statement that we can discuss here. It is a very social definition of art that you're giving. And the other interesting aspect that you spoke of, critical situation, crisis, that you kind of invited to really a mediator, someone who solves a conflict situation in that sense. And again, a crisis, if we look at the term, the Greek term crisis, literally means decision. So a crisis, the moment of decision making. And all your projects, apart from which we saw a little bit in the background, there's beautiful objects, installations, drawings that you do, but mainly you really, are you the mediator or more the activator? Because there's a process happening from which you really can withdraw and you give it to the people. And this is a great challenge, but also purely from a political perspective. So how does this really change the role of the architect today? And we discussed 2 minutes before that it's something that we see more and more happening over the last couple of years, that actually artists are invited as such socially.
Yeah, we just talked about it before. Yeah, I started to talk. So. I spent a lot of time in the Netherlands. In the Netherlands, my friends always tell me, architects or artists, they always tell me that they're used by the governing institutions, that just used, they took their ideas and then they used them to somehow promote marketing of the city. Now, what I think is very important is, of course, artists as a, like a, let's say, a critical person that comes from the outside. Of course, also when we started the project in Venezuela, no one wanted to, no one somehow, basically professional said, you cannot really work in this area because you don't belong here. But as an outsider or a critical observer, it's very important for people, if you are like open and free to exchange knowledge, to formulate with the people on the, let's say, on the ground, new different solutions that are offered differently. And it's also not about neoliberalism and marketing. I think that's very important. What for me is, I'm experiencing this more and more, that I'm asked by, as an artist or whatever I am, to actually also to work with cities. One good example is I'm now working on a project in Aubervilliers, which is a city of, like a suburbia of Paris, and which is one of the most poorest neighborhoods, no, the districts in Paris. And they are actually, we are making a project that is networking, that will make networks of the gardens in Aubervilliers, but also working together with the city that tries by 2014 to have 50 community gardens, and more like 30 are already there. So it's actually also interesting that the municipality of Aubervilliers, of course they will also afterwards say that this is their quality, they understood that community gardens are forms of cohesion in the, and bring towards sustainability of the community, of this, of a particular part of the city.
Apart from the fact that, now a question from the audience, that these gardens are always used for this kind of cultural transformation, where you look at culture and nature as the exact opposite, no? The garden is the cultivated nature. That's another issue. Questions from the audience, Jane, yeah.
Fantastic talk, thank you. It's really nice to hear you talk about your work. I've admired it for a long time, so it's nice to hear you describe it. Just one comment on David Cameron's Big Society, which I think is what you were saying, but just to be clear, I think that what the Big Society agenda does is roll back the state so that business can come in and start making decisions at a local level. Unfortunately, it doesn't really allow for the kind of projects that you're talking about, but that's a bigger discussion. I was really interested in the slide a few back where you had the term social engineering, and I just wondered what you thought about whether architecture can be a relational object in the way that art can be, or whether you think there are still problems of social engineering that kind of reside in architecture and make it different from art.
Yeah, okay, just about, it's actually interesting whenever I mention this quote by David Cameron or by his, always someone from UK comments. And I agree with you, I know what you're talking about. But it's actually at the same time, no one talks that the left parties of Europe, they don't approach the problem. And I think it's very important, as I said before, not just to wait that this will happen and we will get this great monster of the local that will just react to the shrinking of the social state, but you can do something from the other perspective. So, but anyway, about, what was your?
Social engineering.
I would just say this is also something that you experienced in the Netherlands. The Netherlands has a big tradition of social engineering from above to think about how you can structure the society from above. But I think that also what I try to show in this lecture is that the city is also very organic and not planned organism, and it's actually changing. Citizens are changing themselves, the city we live in. So I would maybe just say social architecture against architecture.
Yeah, Anita, hello. Yeah, I'm very happy to see you. Happy to see your presentation. I have two questions. Hopefully, they can work together. The first one is to follow up on Lukas's point about the mediator versus the activator. More specifically about self-organization. The first question is, could you describe specifically as an example of how you have played the role of activating to deploy self-organization in a community, number one, and number two, within the idea of localizing an urban environment, how are you careful of not promoting the gating of communities, the boundary making of communities when you propose localization?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a big question for the future, no? Because I always think that I say that two most successful forms today are like informal city and gated communities. And actually, if you live in an informal city, you also understand that it has a lot, that it controls itself very well. So in a way, it's a gated community as well. And this just tells us that in the future, we will have to, you know, this the modernist city and the idea of democracy is also being reimagined if you look at what spaces are successful today. What was your first question?
Yeah. About self-organization.
Self-organization, I mean, all of these projects are also projects where you learn how to function in the society, and you learn also how to not only organize yourself, but also how to start working with the city. Because like informal city of Caracas, I will just say this because it's very easy to explain. The informal city of Caracas, when we started to work there, they felt they were not a part of the same city. So, for instance, whenever you start a project, you're somehow naive and stupid. So we were interested in the self-built city, so we said, okay, because I like to work with infrastructure, why don't we propose a community to use solar panels? And they would say, we are not interested in solar panels at all. We get the electricity for free. But what they were talking about was stealing electricity from the communal electricity grid. So they didn't see the relationship, that they are a part of the city and it's one organism. So basically what you also learn from community learns from such project is not only self-organization, but also what I think is very important, how to influence the decisions on the city level and to be involved. It was the same for the residents of the community garden.
Thank you very much, Marjetica. We will continue with our questions in the panel with all the speakers. Hand again.